Hi, this is Randall Schwartz, host of FLOSS Weekly. This week, Aaron Newcomb joins me. We're going to be talking about VeraCrypt, the heir apparent to TrueCrypt, encrypting your entire drives so good that nobody can get to them. You're not going to want to miss this, so stay tuned.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TwiT.
Bandwidth for FLOSS Weekly is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com.
This is FLOSS Weekly with Randall Schwartz and Aaron Newcomb, episode 340, recorded June 10th, 2015, VeraCrypt. This episode is brought to you by DigitalOcean, simple and fast cloud hosting built for developers. Deploy an SSD cloud server in 55 seconds. Try it today for free. Visit DigitalOcean.com, and once you sign up, be sure to enter the promo code FLOSS in the billing section for a $10 credit. It's time for FLOSS Weekly, the show about free, Libre, open source software. I am your host, Randall Schwartz, Merlin at StoneEngine.com, bringing you each week the movers, the shakers, the big projects, the little projects, projects you may be using every day and not aware of it, projects you may want to go download immediately after this show and go check out, all sorts of varieties of things. Joining me this week again is Aaron Newcomb. Aaron, welcome back.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Cool. And where are you speaking to us from?
My luxurious study at home. It's really early, so this is where I am today, in my house. It's very nice.
Yes, I'll have to mention for those of us who haven't been following along, we're actually taping at half hour earlier. We were already the earliest show on the TwiT Network, and now we're really the earliest show on the TwiT Network by another half hour. So this is 8 a.m. Pacific time, for those of us on the West Coast, is pretty early to be doing stuff. I'm actually not in Pacific time. I'm in Mountain time. I am, as I've been saying for the last few weeks, I am at YAPSE, the Yet Another Perl Conference. It's sort of the low, more volunteer grassroots sort of conference as opposed to something like OSCON. It's become much more commercial over the years, I have to say. And I'm in a hotel in Salt Lake City. The temple, I think, is like four blocks behind me somewhere here. And because I'm in a hotel, there may be an occasional audio glitch. Please put up with it for that for us. With that, I'll make English out of that somewhere. But the show is not about where we are calling from. The show is in fact about our guests and about the projects that we have on. This week, I am really excited to have these guys on. I'm really excited to have the project on. It is VeraCrypt. I've been a TrueCrypt user for many, many years. In fact, I just invoked it this morning to bring some data onto my encrypted portion of one of my disks. It's usable both as a file encryption system, although that's not the typical way you use it. Normally, you encrypt an entire partition, and it's done using some really high security stuff. Well, about a year ago, TrueCrypt, they abandoned all the development on it. They just simply, shut it up and went away. They updated one last revision, which I'm still not sure what that was about, but I still use a slightly previous version of that. Well, anyway, I'm very happy to have discovered, I think in the last couple of months, that there's an heir apparent to TrueCrypt. It has been forked under the open source sense, and there's now a new project called VeraCrypt, which is taking over from where they left off, and they fixed all the bugs that were known, at least at that point, and they've made it even more secure. There's some stuff they've been putting in there to make that happen. We're going to be talking with, I'm going to mispronounce his name, I should have asked him before we started, Mounir Idrassi, something close to that. He'll say it right when we bring him on in a few minutes. He's been the project leader for this and has been really making some good strides. I mean, it's usable already. That's pretty amazing to me. I've actually played with it a little bit before this show. I built some little file systems and encrypted those. But I haven't yet converted my entire disk because apparently it's a one-way conversion. We'll talk more with him about that too. What do you know about this, Aaron?
Well, I've heard of it, being in the storage industry. I mean, I've heard of VeraCrypt and I've heard of TrueCrypt. Encryption technology is becoming more and more important these days as all sorts of folks are trying to, it seems like, trying to spy on us and get into our stuff. So encrypting your storage technology is very, very important. It's not only important from a personal standpoint, but it's important from a corporate standpoint because if you think about some of the things that have happened recently with Target and other things in the news where people have broken in, if someone gets access to your network and your storage is not encrypted, I mean, they could steal all people's credit card information or personal information. So it could be very dangerous. So this is a very, very important technology. And so I'm excited to talk to our guests today.
And it's also important from the standpoint of it not being something that came from a vendor. You know, I don't know if Apple's disk encryption system hasn't been compromised so that, you know, the powers that be can just come in and attack it and touch it. But if we have an open source software that can do the equivalent, TrueCrypt was that for me for years, and now I believe I'll be starting to move over to VeraCrypt. I know that I can look at every line of source code and even compile it for myself so I can make sure that there's no back doors in there. And I also want to ask our guests about some of that as well. So it's very important. And speaking of vendors, yes, my current main client, ZipRecruiter, requires me to have all my ZipRecruiter material in an encrypted partition. So I have this nice 2 gigabyte file within my file system that is strictly for ZipRecruiter business, and I unencrypt it every morning. I mean, I open it up every morning and it just mounts like another disk, and I do all my work directly within there. Anything more before we move on, Aaron?
No. I mean, that really covers that. I'm kind of a little bit curious about how this complies with government regulations as well, and what the deal is there. Because I know governments require usually that you give them the keys to be able to unencrypt things, especially if you're going to be shipping this overseas. Now, this is being developed in France, I assume, anyway. So we'll have to see what the government policies, what kind of government policies come into play too.
Well, it sounds like both of us have a number of questions to ask our guests, but before we bring them on, I have a very important announcement. Whether you're an experienced programmer or just getting started, you need flexible, reliable, and affordable hosting. DigitalOcean provides developers with droplets, which are virtual private servers that can be customized and quickly deployed to host websites, web apps, production applications, personal projects, virtual desktops, and almost anything else you can think of with full root access. I first found out about DigitalOcean back at Scale, I think about a couple months ago, and they were giving away a code that let me try it for free, and we also have one of those codes, so I'll tell you about it in a minute, and I started playing with it, and one of the things they claimed was you could bring up a new virtual machine in 55 seconds. It's amazing, and it actually did that. As soon as I entered all my billing information, I brought it up in 55 seconds. I'm using FreeBSD. That's the other reason I'm moving them. Hardly any of the hosting people use FreeBSD anymore, which is pretty cool. So it's been built for developers and used by over 400,000 of them, as I said, including me. You can choose your OS, Ubuntu, CentOS, Debian, Fedora, CoreOS, and FreeBSD. That's mine. One-click install allows you to quickly deploy apps like Docker, LAMP, MediaWiki, WordPress, Magento, Ruby on Rails, and many more. You can have up to 20 CPUs, 64 gigs of RAM, and 640 gigs of SSD. Oh, did I mention that before? It's all SSD. Man, that thing builds my packages fast. Highly scalable to meet the demands of rapid growth. They have this wonderful API that lets you fire up machines based on demand. Very cool. Fully featured DNS management to easily manage your domains or use dedicated IPs. And an extremely active community with large and detailed sets of tutorials on all the ways you can use your droplet. You want to deploy Django, set up a personal VPN? They got you covered. So DigitalOcean has incredibly affordable and straightforward pricing. Servers start at only $5 a month. There's also hourly pricing available, starting at less than a penny an hour. But we're going to make it so you can get started today and deploy an SSD cloud server for free. So visit DigitalOcean.com and create an account. Once you confirm your email and account information, go to the billing section and enter the promo code FLOSS for a free $10 credit. That's worth 2 months on a $5 machine. That's plenty to get started and explore what DigitalOcean can do. That's DigitalOcean.com, and once you sign up, enter the code FLOSS in the billing section for a $10 credit. We appreciate DigitalOcean and their sponsorship of Floss Weekly. And now let's go ahead and bring on our guest. Mounir, I'm probably mispronouncing that. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, thank you. Welcome. Thank you for having me.
And how is your name pronounced so I won't keep messing it up?
Mounir, actually. My first name, Mounir.
Oh, that's not too bad. Then I got it pretty close. Good. And where are you speaking? And where are you speaking to us from?
Well, I'm speaking from Paris, in near, actually, not far from Roland Garros. You know, for tennis. So these days, the streets were filled with tourists. So I live not far from Roland Garros, actually, from the tennis courts. So.
Very cool. Very cool. So we gave our impressions of TrueCrypt and VeraCrypt, actually both of us, I guess, being TrueCrypt users. Why don't you give us sort of the 30,000-foot view from your perspective, including how VeraCrypt fits into TrueCrypt's history?
Well, VeraCrypt actually was born as a personal work on TrueCrypt for a customer, actually, because it was like kind of evaluation of TrueCrypt in the context of this customer. And from that point, actually, I discovered some few weaknesses. And I decided back then in 2013 to start VeraCrypt as a new project that would offer some enhanced security. So I started just with first step, which was like strengthening encryption. And yeah, the project was living, you know, it has only very, very small, you know, very small community. And after the mysterious death of TrueCrypt, actually, well, things started to pick up. And actually, well, the development started, you know, to be more intense. And so basically, the idea of VeraCrypt is to try to, you know, to inherit the spirit of TrueCrypt and to add more transparency, to be more open to the user community, and to have a, you know, a very open development process where the features comes mostly from the community, where there is, you know, feedback from people. And you know, because unfortunately TrueCrypt actually it's a very good, you know, very good piece of code, but always the anonymity of the developers was something that is really suspicious, you know. And these days, with all what we are hearing around us, all the changes of, you know, around the policy, you know, for confidentiality, things like that, it's becoming more important for people to know who is behind this or this software. So the first thing that I wanted in VeraCrypt is you know, to go public and to be open, and also to address, you know, the all questions that would come from users, and to clarify them, and to be totally open. So I would say one of the big advantages of VeraCrypt is its openness and its communication, you know, the feedback with the community, which was something lacking from, you know, in the TrueCrypt community, where the authors actually were really, you know, not very communicative, and the forums were not, you know, very active. Well, active, but they didn't participate a lot. So I want to change that, and to, you know, My hope is that VeraCrypt for the next 10 years will continue to be a very strong project that will follow all, you know, the requirements and challenges of the new digital life. So, yes.
For people that haven't heard about, like, you know, full disk encryption systems and what that actually does for you, can you describe, go up a bit of a level and pretend people have never heard of things like TrueCrypt or VeraCrypt, and let people know why they might want to use something like this?
Yes. So actually, we all know, you know, we all carry our confidential information, personal information in USB sticks or USB drives, or even store them in our PC. But they are plain text data. You know, anyone who accesses the PC or the hard drive can read the data. So basically, what TrueCrypt and VeraCrypt bring is a virtual disk, where it adds a layer of protection to your data. And from the usability point of view, you remain, you know, it's transparent for the user. He always accesses a virtual drive. So from the point of view of Windows or Linux or Mac OS X, it's the same thing, you know, it's completely transparent. But under the hood, we have this encryption mechanisms that will take the lead in order to protect the data before they are written to the storage. So that if anybody steals your disk, steals your USB stick, or steals your PC, he will not be able to access your data. So this is basically a transparent encryption layer for all kind of storage.
So you say all kind of storage. What do you mean? Is it just, I know on the website I was looking, it says partitions. What do you mean by all kinds of storage?
So basically, everything that is exposed to the operating system as a storage can be encrypted. So, well, today this is SSD disk, traditional hard disks, USB disks, and the other advantage of TrueCrypt and VeraCrypt is the ability to create virtual drives from simple files. So anything, you know, even if you have a network share or something like that, you can have a file, simple file, which can be, you know, it will be transformed by VeraCrypt to a virtual drive where you can store your data. So from your point of view, you will see like a USB stick, but it's a virtual and it's backed by a simple file. So that's why I say it's compatible with any kind of storage. It can be a physical storage like a disk USB stick or a file system where we create this file that will create our virtual drive.
Right. So this is actually really interesting, and this might be a good example for people who aren't as familiar with encryption just to get them up to speed. So let's say I had a USB stick. Let's say I worked at the NSA, for example, and I wanted to blow some whistles and take some files with me offsite. Not that this would ever happen. But let's just say I did. So I could plug in my USB stick and run some encryption, put some encryption on it, and then unplug it. And then I could give it to, let's say someone in the press, and they could take it, and then they could view that information, or they would have to have a special key, right, to be able to view the information on the USB stick. Yep.
Yeah, you are right. Actually, the encryption is protected by a password, which will give access to the data for people who knows the password. So VeraCrypt supports either password or what we call key files. So a password like any other kind of password, but it can be enhanced with the use of a special file. This file can be MP3 file or text file, anything that is secret, known only to you. And without this file, it will be impossible to open the virtual drive. So basically, we can say it's like two-factor authentication in the sense that you can use traditional passwords and you can combine them if you want stronger protection with what we call a key file. So if I take your example, we can create an encrypted USB drive, put some sensitive data, give it to some kind of lawyer or something like that, and we keep the password for ourselves. And it can be like an insurance policy. If something happens, someone will send the password to the lawyer or to the journalist, and he will be able to access the data. But before receiving his password, this password or the key file, he will not be able to read the data. So this kind of encryption strategy enables, you know, to handle different kind of scenarios, you know, for people who are really, you know, really care about their data.
Yeah. I wanted to bring that home. Obviously, I was alluding a little bit to Edward Snowden because that's, you know, something that people know and are aware of. And I believe he used some of these technologies in order to keep his communications private with some of the journalists that he was communicating to. And so that's just an example. So to get people up to speed to say, you know, why is this important? Like, why would I care about encryption? That's one reason. Like you say, you know, those insurance policies, you know, maybe you're being threatened or maybe something's going on and you need to have that insurance policy. That's another use case. We mentioned several others at the top of the show. But I mean, it just goes to show you how important this technology is. Who's using this right now? Is there anybody that you can mention?
From
that's using this?
From the contact I had, actually. Since I'm French, so there are many French companies who are starting to migrate from TrueCrypt to VeraCrypt, because they like the fact that it's backed by a French developer, and it's easier to talk in French. So it's most popular in France, but from what I see, because I get a lot of feedback from small companies who need some low cost encryption solution, and they don't have the money to invest in complex encryption solutions. And I also had some contact with other really big companies who prefer like the open source aspect, actually. The fact that it's open, there is no backdoor, and especially now after all the revelation about NSA and other operation, people here in Europe are starting to be very worried about all these commercial products coming from America, and they look for alternatives, and European alternatives. Basically, there are some European countries European companies who provide some kind of encryption software, but the open source aspect is becoming more and more important for companies. So basically, the type of people, some early adopters were like technology enthusiasts, but more and more lately, especially since January when I included TrueCrypt support into VeraCrypt, I'm starting to see to have some feedback from companies. But unfortunately, they are not ready to communicate, you know, publicly about this. And this is also another unfortunate aspect, is that many companies, you know, use open source software, but there is little contribution coming to open source projects. And VeraCrypt is no exception. So even if I see a, you know, a huge adoption from many, many professionals, there is very, very little you know, support, very little donation coming to, you know, to contribute and to help the project to continue. So basically, yeah, so it's, well, it's
yeah, I mean,
just
that's really
a personal
important.
Initiative.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes. That's really important because we mentioned this before. I mean, a lot of companies are required, at least in the United States, to give out their encryption keys, especially if they're shipping a product overseas to the government. So you said there's no backdoor. So VeraCrypt doesn't have that problem?
No. There is no problem because the strategy from the beginning was to be completely open and to be completely transparent. So to have, you know, my identity to be public, the source to be readable by everyone, you know, to have clear communication with people. So this was in order to clearly protect against any risk of backdoor or anything else. Because if someone comes and tells me, hey, we want some backdoor into VeraCrypt, I will tell them, okay, I will stop the project, shut the project, and bye-bye. So it's, so, and, but honestly, all the feedback I had till now, I had no, you know, received no pressure, nothing. I had some, you know, contact from French government because when you start to do any encryption thing, you are required to communicate about this. But it was only informative in the sense, okay, what are you doing, things like that. But in French law, since it's an open source project, basically, there is no regulation that blocks the development or that forces the government to force me or others to include some backdoor. So this is not the policy in France. And honestly, I'm also actually what's the feedback that I had is actually the French government is interested in such initiatives, in such open source initiatives, trusted initiatives, because many French companies actually they need such kind of things. They need trust and they need to protects their, you know, their assets using home-built tools. So I think in here in Europe the spirit is a little bit different from the American approach. Actually, even though there are laws in France and other countries for, you know, to access data, to snoop on communications, things like that, but for develop, you know, for security products, there is no backdoor policy. This is really a very big difference compared to the U.S.
Yeah, and then there's another scenario, too, that I want to bring up real quick, and that's, you know, a lot of times if I'm taking a laptop or something through the airport and I get stopped at security or something and they look at it and they see that I have an encrypted thumb drive or they see that I have an encrypted partition on my system, they automatically think, oh, you're trying to hide something. So is that the case with VeraCrypt as well? Will they pick up that, oh, this is an encrypted thing?
Yes, definitely. Even in France, there is a specific law. If you are asked by law enforcement to give a password and you refuse, you can go to jail. This is something, of course, in France, it's like every country actually in the Western world, there are some conditions where they can force you to give the password. So that's why in VeraCrypt, like in TrueCrypt, there are some mechanisms for what we call plausible deniability, where we can create hidden volume inside a decoy volume. And actually no one can prove that there is a hidden volume. So for example, I can encrypt my laptop. And in this laptop, actually, there are two operating systems. There is a decoy operating system who will open up when I type my password. But if I type a different password, it's another hidden operating system who will start up. But if I am stopped at the airport and they force me to give the password, I can give, you know, the normal password. So they will see the decoy operating system. But there is no way they can prove that there is a hidden operating system. I can say no, there is no one, and they have no way to prove that. So actually, this is a protection in this kind of things for people who really, for journalists and other, you know, rights activists, who really need to, you know, to get this kind of protection when they go through checkpoints and airports. The hidden operating system and the hidden volume features are very important for them, and it can protect them against such scenarios.
Sorry, Aaron.
Oh yeah, go ahead, Randall. No,
Okay, I was just actually curious. Do you know enough of, are the original TrueCrypt developers known yet, or have they all been working under some sort of anonymous or pseudonymous action?
Well, no, they are not known. Nobody publicly knows them. But what is suspicious for me is that, well, okay, they are anonymous for us, but definitely they are not anonymous for government agencies, things like that, because they had PayPal accounts, they had US-based organization, they, you know. So basically, there are people in US government and Western country governments who knows the, you know, they know their identity. So they are public for the authorities, but they are not public for us. So, it's not suspicious in itself, but maybe they just wanted to remain anonymous. But for me, for such kind of projects, it's a little bit, you know, because even you are anonymous, you are not accountable. And this is something very, well. And the other aspect, actually, that I discovered when I started working on this is I was amazed by the complexity of the software. And honestly, from what I see in the code, and especially on the Windows part, you know, the device driver, all the kernel stuff, you know, that handles low-level, things under in Windows, it's really well-written, highly configurable. It supports different cases, things like that. And to see such kind of complexity and quality in open-source projects, it's amazing. And for me, you know, as a professional, I estimate the cost of such a development, it's really a huge cost. If I would start a project like this from scratch, I would definitely need more than $1 million to achieve this kind of stability and compatibility. So well, of course, TrueCrypt has lived for more than 10 years. So actually, it's a work that has been going on for more than 10 years, definitely. But honestly, I'm amazed by the efforts and the quality of the code and definitely, they I think they had some support anyway, because doing this only on your weekend and only on your free time, well, I think they really worked like full time or something like that. Not all of them, but at least there are some people, because, and definitely there are many developers, because the style of the code is different from different parts. So at least I guess there are two or three developers in TrueCrypt. And judging from the source code, actually the style, it's old style. Since the project started in 2001, it's not the style of coding of 2001. Actually, it's coding style coming from the 90s. So maybe the people who started TrueCrypt, you know, they were like 40 years old, 45 at the time, things like that. But it's a mix, because when you take the Linux part and Mac OS X part, it's more modern because it's more new. So I think a younger developer, you know, integrated the TrueCrypt team. But the first developers, they were old school developers, you know, and coming from like low level Windows development background. So, but in any way, the TrueCrypt development is a huge effort. Maybe two, three people. But definitely they worked hard, and maybe someone was paying the bills for them, something like that. But definitely the piece of code that we have today and the piece of code that VeraCrypt is built upon is a very good, you know, very professional, very stable, and it's amazing. And personally, because, you know, now I'm starting the project, and especially since last year when lots of people started using it, I receive a lot of, you know, issues, bugs, things like that. And I experience in myself the efforts that is needed to maintain the software, to maintain the quality, and to solve these compatibility issues. It's a huge, because, well, myself, I'm working only on my free time. So I have my job. I do this only on, you know, during the night or weekend, things like that. And that's why the path of VeraCrypt development, well, it's not so quick, you know, it's very slow. But judging by these guys, their release schedule, things like that, it's amazing. It's amazing. Either they were working full time, or I don't know. But it's a huge. What they have done, it's completely unbelievable.
You know, I was about to ask that. So how is this funded? Is this just a labor of love for you, or do you intend eventually to maybe put consulting services around this or something?
My plan actually at the beginning was to start like a VeraCrypt community, developer community around it. And from that point, identify some features. And my strategy is to, you know, to ask for some crowdfunding, because this is the way to go now. You know, if we really need an, you know, open source project that is, you know, that answers the need of the community, we need the community to participate. And participation through crowdfunding, I think, is the way to go. So my strategy is, you know, to maintain the project, to work on it, of course, and after a while, you know, starting this kind of communication with people, bringing mini users in, and you know, and then start some campaign to guarantee some funding. And from that, of course, I can manage it like any project. You know, if there is funding, it can be developed, as, you know, following some plan, things like that. So for now, I'm just maintaining projects. I'm, you know, I doing working hard to, you know, to establish its name, and especially for the next release, I really, you know, want to bring up some cool features. And from that point, I'm already in contact with different, you know, associations in Switzerland, even in US, trying to see how we can come up with some kind of you know, global efforts, and to bring up people who are really interested in this kind of software to help, and to, you know, to bring funding or to bring skilled developers to contribute, things like that. So so I do this also because I believe on the importance of VeraCrypt, basically, yeah, because since the beginning, since I identified some small weaknesses, I felt, you know, like a moral obligation to provide community with this kind of enhanced security. But this personal efforts, it needs some external help, especially, you know, there are many features where my expertise, you know, is limited, like support for new versions of BIOS, like UEFI, things like that. So definitely we need other developers to come in, we need some funding to help pay for them, things like that. So, but anyway, it needs time to start these kind of things. So from now, you know, I just continue and to, you know, to maintain VeraCrypt and to add to its credibility, you know, to answer questions like the one that you're asking. And and from now, after that, you know, hopefully it will pick up and things will be better.
Well, I have a personal experience from having had, you know, 330 guests on this show over the years, that this show gives quite a lot of visibility to people that really need the visibility. So I can imagine you're probably going to have a serious uptick in potential funding solutions and in actual resources. At the end of the show, I'll have you again reiterate the kinds of people you're looking for. And that's the one thing I saw about this project, is we have occasionally open source projects where the primary users of such a project probably aren't developers. And this has that same sort of bias, is that the kind of, you have this kind of, you know, stretch between, you know, the people who can actually make changes to the software and the people who are actually probably going to use it 95% of the time. So, yeah, I can definitely see it about this. We have had a couple questions from the chat room. I want to make sure I don't miss those. Tinker Toy Tech asks, does it have a self-destruct password, like 10 times fail equals erase kind of thing?
Yeah. This kind of feature has been asked lots of times in the past. What people are not aware is that for software solutions like that, this cannot be implemented efficiently, because we are open source software, and an attacker can just, you know, pick the disk, things like that, modify the software to remove this kind of self-destruct feature, and just attack the password. So it's useless, actually. This kind of protection against multiple tries of password can be implemented only for, you know, online services or for hardware components, but for software, it's useless.
Yeah, okay. And also another question from Rock Twist, also is chatting right now in the chat room. Can you ask about plans to support boot drive encryption on Windows with UEFI and GPT?
Yes. Actually, this is the most requested feature above all, because all new PCs, actually, they don't have the legacy BIOS booting mode. They are all using UEFI. The difficulty with UEFI is that it's different sets of API to implement. It needs some really low level expertise. This is something that is missing from my side. I have requested, you know, in different parts of the internet for people to come and help. For now, well, there is only one contribution to a different project called CypherShed, who one guy who contributed some basic UEFI code, but it's still on the, you know, it's not mature, not usable completely. Basically, That's why we need for this kind of project to have really low-level developers to come and join their efforts, because I'm sure there are many, many developers, even in the Linux community, who are more, you know, they have a lot of experience in UEFI support, and they can clearly and easily help VeraCrypt and other TrueCrypt derivatives to integrate this support. It will benefit the community. So this is, yeah, this is lacking. From my side, you know, I started the work a little, but I encountered a lot of technical difficulties, and I didn't personally have time to spend on them. So hopefully, well, we hope that through this kind of communication, we can spread the information and, you know, asking for help from people who have this kind of low-level expertise to come and join and, you know, give us their ideas, give us their help, and hopefully we can achieve something like in 1 year from now. Because if we have, because the expertise is here, you know, when I see Linux distributions supporting UEFI, it's only like this kind of, you know, the on-the-fly encryption, decryption that is missing. This layer, I'm pretty sure there are people on the open source community who can help implementing it. So, well, it's an occasion to ask for help and to ask people to come and look at its source and contribute ideas and code.
Absolutely. You mentioned CipherShed just a moment ago. Do you want to describe what that's about? That came across while I was trying to search for today's show. And
Yes.
What's that all about?
Well, actually, the guys from CipherShed, I had contact with them. The guy who started this called Bill Cox, he contacted me after the end of, you know, after the demise of TrueCrypt, and he found my project. And his idea was to start a new project and to, you know, he asked me to join them. Well, at the time we had a lot of discussions because he had different ideas how to enhance the code, encryption, things like that. But, well, definitely, I was busy in my own project, and I was hoping to attract developers, you know. So for me, well, I couldn't accept to, you know, to leave my project and to join another one. So, but anyway, for me, it's okay to have different projects. It's not a problem, you know. And from that point, actually, well, CipherShed, the initiative, from what I understand, their target is to try to rewrite TrueCrypt, because the problem with TrueCrypt is it uses some special open source license that is not compatible with GPL or LGPL, things like that. So there are some litigation coming from it. So the people from CipherShed want really to have like this kind of fork that is completely compatible with GPL. So the spirit, as I understand it, is to write components, all the components of TrueCrypt, in order to come up with a compatible solution that is completely compatible with GPL. My approach was different in the sense that, for me, the end user doesn't care about the license. The end user wants only secure solution. So for me, my objective is to provide secure solution to work on hardening encryption, to solve issues, to solve things like that, and to provide, you know, a quick release cycle in order to be able to catch up with all vulnerabilities, things like that. So the spirit of VeraCrypt is a little bit different from the spirit of CipherShed. And, well, it has been a long time I didn't, you know, communicate with CipherShed people because, honestly, you don't have a lot of free time. But I don't know where they are now. From what I see, well, they are still, you know, in the development. But my personal opinion, it will be really hard for them to come up with a full GPL solution because, as I told you, the crown jewel of TrueCrypt is the Windows kernel driver. And this piece of code is huge. It's huge. And writing something that is GPL from scratch, it will take years to achieve the same stability. So that's why, for me, the end user cannot, especially these days, we can't afford waiting for years to come up with secure alternatives. The alternatives should be given now, and to provide users with, you know, with means to protect their data. So that's why, well, it's a different philosophy. We don't have the same approach, but for me, it's good to have different, you know, different people, different ideas, different mindsets, because at the end, it's the end user who will win. Definitely.
And I want to touch on this just a little bit, but one of the complaints I saw about CipherShed is that the project leader or something has been a defense contractor from time to time?
Yeah. Because in his LinkedIn profile, he was very open about it. He's an independent consultant. He worked with DoD on different stuff, things like that. So yeah, definitely, it was not very good image for CipherShed, especially with all the stories we hear about NSA. So this is one of the big issues, and especially here in Europe, definitely people are very, very sensitive about this. Very, very sensitive, and so at least in Europe, it will be hard to, you know, to get people trust CipherShed because of this aspect. Even though, you know, the Jason is very open about this, and he really was very, you know, cooperative as answering all kinds of questions. But unfortunately, you know, every time you have this tag, this, you know, DoD or NSA, things like that, today is becoming very, very bad publicity, unfortunately. So for this kind of project, well, it's better to avoid any links and to, you know. So, well, I don't know their strategy in the long term for CipherShed, but definitely if they really want people to, you know, to put the efforts behind them, well, they have to work on this anyway.
Yeah, definitely an image issue there. We actually had a couple of questions in the chat room sort of over time. Was, TrueCrypt can do this, can VeraCrypt also do this? And I was thinking you might as well go ahead and say it's pretty much the same code, but better, right?
Of course, yeah. We kept in VeraCrypt, I kept a lot of features, you know, almost all the features, you know, and I added new ones. So basically, the most important thing was compatibility, in the sense that the algorithms, a random generator, the encryption, all the core stuff is the same. Work was done to fix vulnerabilities, to correct bugs, a lot of bugs, and to add stronger encryption. And some new features to add to help usability, things like that. So, and definitely, for example, the next version, it will add a new feature, like what I call dynamic mode, which, like, you know, because till now, like, the strength of the encryption was static, in the sense that it's linked to your password. You know, you have like some kind of, you know, iteration stuff, but it's your password. It's one-dimensional security. So in the next version, I implemented a feature that I call dynamic mode, which basically adds a two-dimensional security where you have different parameters. You know, you have your password, but you can also have a different parameter I called PIM for personal iteration multiplier. So this kind of enhancements, I try to add enhancement for security, things like that, but the main features are the same. So for people coming from TrueCrypt, for them, the transition is very easy.
And so one of the things I also noticed when I was trying to play with it was that it needed to convert my TrueCrypt volume to a VeraCrypt volume. Why was that needed? And of course, it's one way. How well can I trust that it's going to work, do the right thing?
Yeah. So basically, since we kept all the underlying encryption format the same, what changes is the strength of the protection. You know, how your password is transformed to the unlocking key. The TrueCrypt transformation is not strong enough. So VeraCrypt, we added, you know, more strength to this part. So actually, the conversion it's very easy. So it's just we change, you know, the lock if you want, just simple lock. But we keep all the stuff the same. So there is no risk actually in converting. So and for people who don't want to convert, it's okay. VeraCrypt can still open TrueCrypt volumes and TrueCrypt disks without any modification. Just you have to check the corresponding checkbox and it's okay. So it's not mandatory to convert, but for better security, especially for those who don't use strong passwords, it's better to convert to VeraCrypt.
So this actually goes into a question, another question from the chat room. Jake was asking about since the core, you know, since you started with TrueCrypt, isn't it possible that there's some sort of backdoor or something you don't know about? That you know, could be used to provide a backdoor, since you're using the TrueCrypt code.
Yes.
You know,
yes,
isn't that always a possibility?
Well, honestly, I have been working on this code for more than 2 years now. Not only me, many people reading all the cryptographic code, all the layers, and to say that there is a backdoor there that has escaped review, but active developers for more than 2 years, either it is something that is really supernatural, you know, backdoor, or but no, definitely I don't see anything. I don't see anything. Most of the vulnerabilities and weaknesses that have been discovered, it was about leaking some information, like the memory address, vulnerability in the random generator, things like that. But in the source, there is no real. There is no backdoor. And honestly, from my knowledge and from others, it's not possible because the code we have, you know, I personally have read it many times, you know, and I know it by heart. So I don't see where that backdoor could exist.
Yeah, and I would echo my sentiments here, which is that's why open source software is so important, because you can actually go in and look at the code, and if there is some sort of problem, you know,
of course,
it can be identified, as opposed to proprietary code where you have no idea. There could be vulnerabilities and you have no idea. So
yeah.
I wanted to get to implementation for people that haven't done this. Like, I haven't done this except for testing a few things. I really haven't played around with TrueCrypt that much. So I wanted to get, just so people who haven't done this before, give them a feeling for how hard this is to implement. Let's say I've got a Linux system and I want to set this up on a partition. What are the steps involved? How hard is it to set up? There was a question, in fact, you might want to address this too, from the chat room. Esol asked, does VeraCrypt make it very easy to compile? I know that TrueCrypt had some strange dependencies on some other things, and how easy is it to compile? So talk about implementation for a minute.
Yeah. Okay. Well, the first steps actually in VeraCrypt was to work on the build system of TrueCrypt. Actually, TrueCrypt developers released the source code, but the build system was not 100% reproducible. You know, there were some missing components, some missing dependencies. For example, even for Linux, completely the build scripts were missing completely. So one of the big efforts in VeraCrypt was for me to standardize the build system for Windows, Linux, Mac, and to make it as straightforward as possible. The first reason was for me, because I wanted something easy, maintainable, very easy to build. And second, also for others to be able to build some same binaries like me. So for development, one of the big advantages of VeraCrypt is it's really straightforward to compile. I put a lot of effort on this, and to document all the missing components and dependencies. After that, you know, especially on Linux and Mac, a lot of people are compiling their own binaries. I had a lot of feedback about that, so this is really very smooth. From the usability point of view, the question about how the steps required to encrypt, the spirit of TrueCrypt, which exists also in VeraCrypt, is it tries to guide the user through using wizards, where, you know, we're trying to explain through some texts what are the steps required to protect disks and to create virtual disks, things like that. So basically, to encrypt a disk on Linux or on Mac, or even Windows, it's just a matter of following instructions. And basically, the safest way is to start from a blank disk and to create a new VeraCrypt volume on it. So it's empty disk, and you encrypt it from the beginning, and then you start to use it. So it's encryption. It only takes like 4 or 5 clicks, you know, specifying your password, selecting your disk. You can leave your default algorithms. They are the best. And then just leave VeraCrypt encrypting disk. When it's done, you mount it, and it's okay. You can start putting your data. So actually, the steps are not very complicated. There is on the website of VeraCrypt a beginner tutorial with some kind of, you know, pictures, you know, steps that people can start, like a first step to understand how does it work. The tutorial was done on Windows, but same applies to Linux and Mac. So basically, I encourage users, you know, to download, to look up in the documentation, to start with the tutorial, you know, the beginner's tutorial, to play around. And they, you know, once they have the spirit in mind, you know, how does it work, you know, the notion of virtual drive compared to physical drive, once it's learned, it will be easy for day-to-day use. So in this sense, VeraCrypt kept all the logic from TrueCrypt. Of course, in the future, indeed, for simple users who are not IT guys, of course, the graphical user interface is very complex. there are too many options, too many steps, even if there are already a lot of default parameters. So next step in VeraCrypt actually is to try to define, actually to remove, you know, the this complex GUI and to implement a expert mode. So the default mode will be like easy mode with very little parameters, default hidden parameters, safest parameters with few clicks, and for experts, bring up the current GUI to surface. So this is the next, you know, and this will be a huge step forward because it will help democratize this kind of encryption solution. Because for now, I see it even with some friends who are not IT, when I show them, you know, the interface, they are a little bit lost, you know. They need some help to understand the steps required. But so definitely, the big step forward is usability and to define a new graphical user interface. And for that, if people can help with ideas, with proposals, you know, people who are, you know, more experts on how to help users, you know, using software, they are welcome to come and join and, you know, propose their ideas. So this is a field that needs a lot of work to do.
Yeah, I really appreciate you mentioning the usability and making this easy for average users, because so many times developers miss that aspect of it. It's like, oh yeah, we all know how to live on the command line, so you know, of course, we can just type this and then we all know what we're doing. But in reality, to get people to actually use this, especially an important tool like this, it's very important to make it easy. So I'm really glad that you mentioned that that's a focus. In fact, if we look at your website, maybe John can pull that up. Just wanted to give people a feel for some of the things that you have done here. Even this is the Windows wizard, but just the fact that you have a wizard and you kind of step through, like you mentioned, people may not know exactly what all these things are, but if they know, you know, if they can just step through this and pick their volume and set it up, I think that's really, really important. And you've got some other examples here about different encryption options and languages and things like that. So this is, I mean, this is pretty already, I think it's more user-friendly than other software I've used, certainly. And the other thing that I wanted to compliment you on that goes along with this is the documentation you have as well. You have really good for an open source project. And I don't know how much of this came from TrueCrypt and how much of it is you're doing.
Yeah, but, actually,
the documentation is great.
Yes. This documentation mostly came from TrueCrypt. My contribution was to, you know, actually modify to add some specific VeraCrypt aspects. I worked on the frequently asked questions section to add some new aspects, to answer some new questions. But a lot of work was done to convert, actually, the TrueCrypt documentation format to make it more, you know, more easy, more readable. So the content itself comes mostly from TrueCrypt. And that's why another aspect when I told you that a lot of effort was done in TrueCrypt is it's very rare to find such kind of open source projects with this quality of code and quality of documentation. And that's why, as I said, a lot of effort was, you know, someone was helping a lot, even with money or something like that, but I don't know, but it's many people were working on TrueCrypt, and definitely it's a, you know, so VeraCrypt, actually I integrated the documentation. I had to rewrite it, to work it a little, to adapt to the format, to the website, but most of the information come from TrueCrypt, actually.
Yeah, that's great. Another question, I mentioned for the entry-level users that GUIs and wizards are great, but I do want to also say for those techies out there like me that like to live on the command line, if I'm familiar with TrueCrypt on the command line, is everything that's going to be the same with VeraCrypt, or is there differences that I have to adjust to?
We kept in VeraCrypt all the command line arguments, command line switches, the same. Some new ones were added to adapt to the features of VeraCrypt. On Windows, I had to correct some issues in the handling, because actually the code that handled the command line parsing on Windows was not very robust, actually, and it lacks some robustness. So I had to modify. So some people who used some weird syntax in TrueCrypt, maybe it will not work. But if they stick with the official documentation, it will work, no problem. So mainly, taking scripts from TrueCrypt and plugging them to VeraCrypt, it's straightforward. It will work.
no problem. Of course, we there are some new switches that we recommend to add to enhance performance because of the increased security in VeraCrypt, there are some delays when opening volumes. So people may be surprised because for them they say, when I use TrueCrypt, it took me 1 second to open a volume. Now it takes me 5 seconds. What's this? They don't understand. So there are some switches to try to enhance this. But mainly, the main difference is, you know, to understand the philosophy behind VeraCrypt, the increased security. Yeah.
Yeah, one other thing that I wanted to ask, I know we're running short on time probably, but it's just so interesting. What about in general, just performance implications? what happens to performance when I encrypt something? You know, because basically I'm going through another level. So if I'm writing an application, if I'm a developer, and performance is key, but I need to keep my some portion of my data encrypted, what are the performance penalties?
Yeah, basically it all depends on the hardware where you're running the code. So basically, the best solution for people who need high performance, we advise to use the AES hardware in CPU. So for example, the AES NI, it's an extension in CPUs where the AES encryption is done in hardware. So when you use such kind of hardware, which is now mainstream almost, the overhead of encryption is very, very, very low. It's like I have done some calculation before. It's around maybe 5% or, you know, 5-6% loss in performance. So it's very, very low overhead when you use this kind of hardware encryption. But if it's pure software, of course, the overhead is very huge and you can really divide by two the performances, especially for people who are working on video, things like that, things that needs high bandwidth. Encryption, of course, can be can degrade performance. So, but usually when you work with sensitive data, I recommend to use, you know, AES in hardware. It's the best solution.
Well, Mounir, it's been really wonderful chatting with you, but we're almost out of time. We're up against pretty much our at least our soft deadline, if not our hard deadline already. And I have to say that the chat room has been going wild on this particular episode. Lots of questions coming from the chat room today. I have to ask, though, is there anything we didn't ask you that you really hoped we were going to ask you?
Well, I think we covered most of the aspects. I was really, you know, I wanted to talk about the fact that we need a community to come up and to, you know, all the people, you know, with technical knowledge to come and look at the project to give their advice, and also for people who are more onto the crowdfunding, things like that, to also help to see how we can, you know, bring up some kind of funding effort to help take the project to the next level and to bring some new features like the EUFI you mentioned. So basically, these were the points that I was expecting, and I think we covered them. So now it's up to the community, and hopefully we can get some good publicity thanks to this show.
Very good. And also, I have to ask my two required questions or I get email about it. So what's your favorite scripting language?
I don't know. Well, actually, I love Python.
Oh, okay. And what's your favorite text editor?
Text editor, it's Notepad++, because actually the developer of Notepad++ is a French guy who worked with me. We worked together in a French company, so it's Ho. I don't know if you know him, but I think it's the best text editor in the world.
Okay. Well, I didn't win anything on either of those points. But again, Mounir, we could have gone another hour with this show. I mean, I'm actually feeling kind of bad that I have to let you go now, but we only have a limited time slot. So thank you very much for coming on the show.
Thank you.
I hope that you get your call for action comes to fruition. I think very much will, given the whole apropos of how do we encrypt things now that the government can break into everything kind of stuff. You know, all the tinfoil hats out there are probably going crazy. Oh, my, it's VeraCrypt. That's it. We got to go use it now. So this is all great. So thank you for being on the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me, and hope to see you soon.
Very good. Very good. That was Mounir Idrassi. And what do you think, Aaron?
This is really exciting. I mean, and really important. And I hope that we illustrated some examples of that throughout the show. I mean, hopefully everybody can get that this is an incredibly important technology for a number of reasons, not just because, you know, we want to be sneaker netting things around the office. But just, you know, I don't want my data out there, especially my bank account information or my credit card information out there, free for everybody to snoop around in, or maybe not even everyone. Maybe it's nefarious folks to snoop around and get a hold of. So I think this is very, very important from that aspect, just in general. And I think it's also important that there's an open source supported software stack for doing encryption like this. So like we alluded to on the show, people can actually get in and help track down bugs if there are any, or vulnerabilities, and make this really, really as secure as possible. So, I'm just grateful to be on. I didn't know about VeraCrypt and now I do. So as always with this show, it's like, oh, I'm going to go out and try this right now. I'm sitting here, doing some research off to the side, it's just a half listening because I'm so excited about this. But yeah, it is. It's an exciting technology. And I wish them all the best. I hope that people can find ways to help them out because it really, really is important technology.
Absolutely. And again, I'm going to, again, promote this as much as I can everywhere. And I'm going to see if I can migrate all my stuff over to VeraCrypt, the stuff that I've actually got going, especially the stuff I have in TrueCrypt right now. Again, like I said, we could have talked to him for another hour easily. So many other points that sort of were going by in the chat room and things that we just didn't get to. Sorry about that, chat room. Hopefully we hit the most important ones. All right. Well, let me talk about upcoming guests. We have some exciting guests coming up as well. We have SatNogs, which is next week. SatNogs, which is satellite ground stations with commodity hardware. Augur, which I don't understand at all, but luckily we're bringing experts on. It's decentralized open source prediction market application platform. Buzzword bingo people will be winning on that one. Okay. Free switch telephony platform. We've talked a lot about things like Asterisk and stuff. I think Free Switch is built on top of Asterisk, maybe something like that. Anyway, just before OSCON, we have Rachel, I'm going to mispronounce this, Romalitis, who is one of the program chair there, talking about what will be happening at OSCON. Kind of getting you excited about that as well. We'll have a show, DigiCam, sorry, I lost my place. DigiCam, which is advanced digital photo management. Think like, for example, an open source version of iPhoto, or I'm sure there's the equivalent of it on the Windows side or whatever. So that ought to be cool. OSCON, we're going to actually be at OSCON. We're going to get a surprise guest there. We won't know until we actually show up at the show, see what the news is going to be that week, and probably bring on somebody who's going to break news right on this show at 8 a.m. in the morning on OSCON day. Later on, a couple weeks later, we've got Dart, the Dart programming language. We've got the actual two creators of Dart, Lars Back and Casper Lund, going to get us up to date on the changes in Dart over the last couple of years, since we had Seth Ladd on talking about Dart as sort of a promotion thing. We just added to the list, in fact, just like minutes before the show, I added Gambus, which is a free object-oriented BASIC inspired by Visual Basic. Actually, the project's been going on for about 10 years, and that ought to be pretty interesting. And then the last currently scheduled one is Ichinga, which is a fork of Nagios, a scalable and extensible monitoring system. Many of you probably use Nagios. Fewer of you probably use Ichinga, but that's, sort of the fork from there. We're still looking for more guests for Q3, I guess it would be. I think Q2 is full. Yeah, Q3 is still open. You can always find out our progress on that by going to twit.tv/floss, and you'll see our current people that are scheduled and the people we're trying to get scheduled. If there's some project that you want on there that we don't have yet, please have the project leader email me. So you contact the project, have the project leader or their community representative, whatever, email me, and we'll put them right on the list. We do have a live stream. We have a lot of questions from the chat room today. We are on at 8 a.m. Pacific time. That's new now. It used to be 8:30, but we are now very much the earliest show on the Twit Network at 8 a.m. Pacific on Wednesdays. You can go to live.twit.tv and follow along with us and see what we're doing. You can follow us at Floss Weekly on Google+. I announce all the things that are happening up there. That automatically migrates over to Floss Weekly if you'd rather follow us on Twitter. Twitter, Floss Weekly. There we go, at Floss Weekly. You can follow me at Google+, Randall L. Schwartz. And that gets posted over to Merlin, M-E-R-L-Y-N, on Twitter if you want to follow me that way instead. I will be at FISLE, the big open source conference in Brazil. 5,000 attendees. I'll be there in July, and I'll actually be talking about Dart. I'm writing a Dart course, I'm writing a one-hour introduction to Dart based on all the other good tutorials I've seen so far, but I'm writing it from scratch because I want to know how to actually teach this stuff, because I want to start writing books about it. I should be giving away my strategy here. Anyway, I think it's enough plugging for me. Aaron, what do you want to plug today?
Well, you can follow me on Google+. I've been so busy lately that I haven't actually been on much lately, but I swear I'm going to get back. I've just been so busy with the nonprofit that I run, Benicia Makerspace. We're getting ready for our grand opening on July 11th, And there's actually a couple fans of the show that have one of them is moving, I think, close to this area. I don't want to say his name because I haven't asked him if I can mention it. But a fan of the show is moving close to the area. And he's like, oh, I'm so glad there's a makerspace near where I'm going to be moving. I'm going to be coming up and joining very soon. So that's exciting. And but it's a lot of work. And so you can always follow what I'm doing at Benicia Makerspace or follow what we're doing as a community, I should say, at BeniciaMakerspace.org.
Absolutely wonderful. Thank you. And Aaron, thank you again for joining me as co-host.
Oh, absolutely. I'd love to be on. It's I'm not going to lie. It's going to be a challenge to get up and get into the brick house by 8 o'clock for this new time slot. But I'll do my best. We'll see if I can make it work. Maybe I'll just come spend the night.
Yeah, you get up at 5, right? And then be on the road by 6:30. Would that make it?
Yeah, I'll just have John set out a cot for me the night before, and I'll just go awesome. Sleep in the back room or in the basement.
At least you didn't make the mistake I made this morning. I think I was only telling the live stream, but I was well admit it. And the thing, I actually got up, I'm on mountain time, and I actually got up 1 hour too early. I was all ready for the show as if it was going to begin at 7 a.m. So I've just been, what the heck? I can't do my time zone math anymore. All right, we've chatted it up. I got to get going. We'll see you all again next week on Floss Weekly.